Welcome to dinner at the Roundtable Podcast with DJ John Tavar, Nelly Nell, Chris Ryder, and Bodega the DJ on the ones and twos. Your source to knowledge. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram at dinner at the Roundtable. Welcome to dinner at the Roundtable Podcast with DJ John Tavar, Nelly Nell, Chris Ryder, and Bodega the DJ on the ones and twos. Your source to knowledge. Follow them on Facebook and Instagram at dinner at the Roundtable.
Is this what you want?
Channel 5.
Like we must be doing something right. Young and made a stack, hustling every night. She must be doing something right. Young and made a stack, dancing every night. Got 100 rounds like a young and had 100 max. Move 100 pounds, gave 100 daps. I used to bag the crack up. I pray to God I flow up, hit the block and post up, made a grand just cause I showed up.
Channel 5.
I glowed up, now I got your whole bruh, and I'm fucking both hoes in the new club. They like we must be doing something right, young and made a stack, hustling every night.
Hey y'all niggas know the fucking vibes. Every day we pray for the
Rola.
We live another day for the
Rola.
Getting that pay for the
Rola.
Doing okay cause
Rola. Nigga, I'm live, nigga. What the fuck sex you want on the live, nigga?
You got a drug deal for the
Rola. You know we need to the wrong guy, stupid.
You know shit was wicked. Okay, we was living, man, drug infested. Little did we fucking know we was well connected. Colombians had Dominicans well respected. You was smoking crack or that butt naked. Every block had work, none of them neglected. Niggas ain't care, they was living hectic. Cause they was getting paid off every second. And you could've come half step. Cause any little nigga would've had a weapon. Niggas would've broke your little glass jaw. So I gotta hit you with these last four. Grab the crop, it's the last straw. Fish scale, the glass raw. Hey, niggas fucking pray for the. We live another day for the. Getting that pay for the. Doing okay, cause the. Motherfuckers kill for the. We got a drug deal for the. You know we never squeal for the. But we kept the pill for the.
Boyfriend that he better chill, yo le entro a plumas. Mami, dame dato, eh? Mami, dame dato. When I hit it in the bed, clack, clack, yo nunca fui un novato.
Never been a rookie.
El puré that we be smoking to the head, me da duro en el caco.
Light it to the head, baby.
Tell your boyfriend that he better chill, yo le entro a plumas. Mami, dame dato, eh? Mami, dame dato. Dame luz, baby. Yeah, I came with protection, ain't going through, baby. Got a couple cuatro malos for the crew, baby. And a new side joint, she's my new baby. When I tell her suck this, ain't no calimete. I'm just trying to hit and quit, puta clarinete. When I give her a nine, yo le meto el huevete. Tito swing on a pussy, cual I mete paquete. Matter of fact, she be calling me Omega Fuerte. Try to ask me for money, le dije buena suerte. But she talking gibberish, I don't give a mente. Cause I be living in love, y yo suelto la gente. Nah, baby, yo no tengo tiempo. Cause I ain't really trying to catch feelings, baby, lo siento. I'm a bad influence, yo soy mal ejemplo. Waiting for that call, mami, dame un momento. Mami, dame dato.
Dame like.
When I hit it in the bed, clack, clack, yo nunca fui un novato.
swung into the head, me da duro en el cat. Tell your boyfriend that he better chill, yo le entro a plumas. Mami, dame dato. Mami, dame dato. When I hit it in the back, yo nunca fui un novato. El puré that we be smoking to the head, me da duro en el cat. Tell your boyfriend that he better chill, yo le entro a plumas. Mami, dame dato.
I am DJ John Tavall, Lenny Nail, Chris Wright, and Bodega the DJ in the background. We got a special guest.
We got my boy Taino Domingo, author of Vengeful. Yes, say what's up to the people.
What's going on, man? Welcome, man.
Cyber World. What's happening?
Clap right
here.
Big
tank of the building, Harlem Sugar Hill Gang, yeah.
We're going to get more in depth in the book later on, but I just want to say, you definitely, people, you got to read this book. It's available on all platforms. You know, it's called Vengeful by Taino Domingo. And it's, you know, it's not a long read, but it's definitely, you know, it's a lot and a little. And it's a really good book, man.
And, you know, since Amazon is the most popular way to buy now, it's definitely available on Amazon.com, absolutely, right? Correct?
Amazon, iTunes, yeah. Barnes & Noble, if you, .com, wow. Kindle.
That's what's up.
Yeah, if you like reading digital books, you can get a digital
physical
too.
Physical or digital, whichever you want.
Mm. Analog or digital.
Right there for you.
Wow. That's what's up, man. Yeah, well, tonight's topic is kind of related to the book. I mean, we're going to talk about it later on, but tonight's topic is HIV. We're going to definitely talk about, you know, the history behind that. And is it really, you know, a man-made thing or, you know what I'm saying? Because it's a lot, man. But as we always do, current events, though, man, what's going on, though?
Chilling, man. So we had the MLB popping off.
Bum-ass Yankees is out of the World Series.
So the Astros and the Yankees series. The Yankees lost last night.
Bum-ass
Yankees. Heartbreaking
situation.
Yeah, no.
Bum-ass Yankees.
There was down.
Bum-ass Yankees.
Can I explain what the hell happened? That's the Mets.
Bum-ass Yankees. That's
all. Y'all can say whatever y'all want, but at the end of the day,
You a Mets fan too?
Watching it?
Yeah, he was, man. We're talking about that over here. Tank's a Mets fan. That's why, you know, that's why we vibe on another level, because, you know, we share the same kind of pain.
So the Yankees were down 4-2 in the ninth, top of the ninth. DJ LeMahieu was able to bring him back, tied up. He gave a 2-1 homer.
And then Altuve, bang!
So over. the game went up 4-2-4, and we bring in Chapman, thinking that he was going to hold it down for
bang,
us.
Bang.
But for some reason, he wasn't using his fastball.
Bang bang!
To knock these guys out, because he's known bang, for bang. His fastball. Mm-hmm. He was using his slider. He was letting it hang. So
bang bang!
We got one out at first, and then we had Altuve batting, which is an incredible baseball player.
5'9", bro.
5'6", actually.
He's actually 5'6", or 5'9", damn.
Venezuelan.
Boy, my height, man.
Yeah, man. Mm. He relies on, like, mistakes that the pitchers do. Like, he's a real good precision contact hitter. Okay. And he has power for being such a little guy. And he seen that Chapman was letting that slider hang. He waited for it, knocked it out. My whole thing was, you know, being that Altuve was the hottest player in the postseason, been the hottest player in the postseason.
Should have walked
5 him. Home runs. Been out. His base percentage has been crazy. He should have walked him, intentionally walked him, and then gone against the next guy. He probably would have had a better chance. Maybe a double play. Would have gone to extra innings. He probably would have done something. But at the end of the day, we still lost. You know, say we don't, we don't make no excuses. We don't make no excuses.
Bum ass Yankees.
I was hearing a sob story right now.
Bum ass. Yo.
He was trying to.
Yo, Tank.
Listen, let me tell you something.
My man locked himself in his room for about 3 days. He didn't want to talk to nobody.
You can't listen. The number threes and number twos are always going to make excuses because number one is number one. And number one is always going to be the Yankees. We're the best baseball team.
They haven't been the best baseball team since 2009. It's been 10 years.
Can I finish?
Nah, you
can't be annoying. You're annoying, Mets fans.
I'll let you finish.
Yeah,
let it finish.
So, 27 championships, the best baseball team in the history of baseball, statistically, right?
In sports, though.
In sports. So, let's just leave it like that, and then you guys can shit talk now. Look how he took a deep breath.
The base begins right
this
now.
This is the only thing that I want to know, right?
Yeah, go ahead.
It's like a Knicks fan saying, yo, but we made it to the playoffs.
Nah, but.
How long ago? Nah. I let you go.
The Knicks and the Yankees different.
I let you go. I let you go.
He's tight right
I'm
now.
I'm just trying to
he's
make.
Tight, Tank. He's tight right now. That's fine.
Tell you, show you a comparison of what you just finished speaking about.
All right.
Now, only thing I'm trying to tell you is this. Don't tell me about what happened 10 years ago, bro. 27 happened when? 10 years ago, bro.
But that's the last time they won a...
The last time they won a chip. Well, 09 was the last.
That was, that's, that was what?
10. Yeah,
thank
exactly.
you. I think that's what I said.
2009.
But anyways, like I was saying, right? He just finished
talk your
saying
shit,
Tank.
Talk your shit.
The number one team. There's only one number one team. And how do you become the number one team? By winning the championship, right? So obviously they're not the number one, two, or three. They're home.
Wow.
Watching who's going to be number one.
Yep.
Mm. You understand what I'm saying? Damn, so listen, man. Damn. It's all good. It happens to every team.
Yeah, it does.
Don't cry now.
Now, the only thing that I will say, there's no reason in the world why someone that throws over 100 miles per hour
shouldn't use that.
Would like to throw two breaking balls in a row to a caliber batter as Altuve is. Yes, granted, but he did. Now, they're probably listening to our show right now. And the interview going God on right now.
Did you see his smile, though, when Altuve, he knew, as soon as Altuve made contact with the ball, you knew it was leaving the park.
Bro, listen.
It was one of those, like, you know what I'm saying?
No doubt.
Let me explain something to you.
And Chapman just smiled and grinned because he knew he had fucked up. Like, bro, he was like, damn, I should have never threw the hanging slap ball.
I'll give props due. You all are a good team. The best team in New York. Let's just say that.
Best team in the history of baseball.
In New York.
In the history of baseball.
Listen, we're not talking about past tense.
Okay,
we're talking about right now.
All right, bet.
You guys are the best in New York.
Okay.
Now, that's y'all rode that wave in this series, and look what happened.
You guys
left 1,000 people on base.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, listen, at the end of the eighth, I don't even have it any longer.
We put it back.
I put, I put on my phone, on my IG story. I That's said, listen, crazy. Man, if you know any junkie fans.
Junkie.
You know what I'm saying?
Better junkie
Do me
fans.
A favor.
Junkies.
Make sure you stay around them and keep them on suicide watch.
Holy shit.
Yo, no, because I already
I'm here,
knew
I'm here for you, my
where
brother.
This is going. Yeah, and yeah. I just want to say, my brother, I got big shoulders. They can handle your big frame. You know what I'm saying? It's all right, man.
But this
you know, it's always next year, man.
Now, I want to say this.
That's what I was trying to say. That when you're the greatest who's ever
How
done it,
you,
you don't.
Greatest?
The Yankees are the greatest who's ever done it. So we don't cry, man. We just multiply.
Right
we come
now,
back
it sounds
next
like you're crying.
He is. He's making excuses right
gentlemen,
now.
Gentlemen, can
he's make
I was just making.
Does he sound like he's making an excuse?
I was just.
Or is it just me? I mean, if it's just me, I can take.
I was just giving a breakdown of what my, you know, my perception of the game. Went down. I wasn't.
This is what
it.
This is
Chris,
what it is.
Help me out with
this is what it is, though. I'm gonna tell you what happened with the Yankees.
What happened?
They built their whole entire team on their offense and their bullpen. Now, baseball, you know, in the postseason, it's not about who has the best offense. It is who has the best pitching.
Mm.
The Astros had the best starters and they had the best bullpen.
Mm.
Plain and simple. And their hitters were big time when it counted.
Mm.
The Cashman's MO, which to me, I'm going to give mad respect to Cashman because he's probably one of the best general managers, period.
He's the best. He's the best.
You know what I'm saying? Because he has been the GM of the New York Yankees for, what, 20-some-odd years?
Damn,
you know, over
that's
20 years. And he, you know, he built that team up with – he. To be honest with you, the Yankees have not signed any really big free agents in a while.
Yeah.
You know, I'm talking about they used to get the best five every year. Now, they calmed down. They started focusing on the farm system, which the Yankees had one of the best farm systems in
always,
the game.
Because
you got, you know, Gleyber Torres came out of there, Judge,
Torres, I told you,
you know, but he got, but he came up through that, even though he was a trade. But
well, he was a young player that came to the Yankees.
His MO has always been he can't find the starting pitches. He can't. He can't do it.
Listen,
we've had in the past, though.
He Cashman's never been able to get great starting pitches. Never.
He should have just invested in a pitcher during the free agency this year.
Yeah.
Because y'all knew from July that y'all was going to make it this fall. So it made no sense.
They could have got Marcus Stroman. He was on the block and then the Mets got him.
Exactly.
He went to the wrong side of the city.
It doesn't
funny.
The difference doesn't make because if he would have been with y'all right now, he'd be sitting right next to the Mets.
Same thing.
No, maybe he would have made it.
Y'all just went home a little bit later.
Hey, listen.
You know, it was like that Tank. It was like that Geico commercial with the fishing poles. Like,
hey, man.
You almost had it. You almost had it. Here goes. Oh, you want to go to the World Series?
Let's move on, though, man.
You know, Game 7.
New
York Giants.
I don't want to throw up on this mic.
Saquon Barkley returned today. Played pretty well. His ankle held up. I was just reading that he was
Giants
did a good job. They should have freaking won that game.
The Giants did lose to the Cardinals.
They should have won that game, man. They had so many opportunities.
Listen,
but the Cardinals D played good.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that I'm gonna say.
27-21.
Yeah.
I don't want to.
And they should have won that game. They should have scored 30 in that game.
This horse any more than everybody else has, but Pat Sherman has to go. This guy doesn't know how to call any plays. Only reason
he fucked up on the clock management toward the end of the game.
Like
why?
First of all, not even necessarily that. Like let's call it what it is. You know, everything now is going through phases. What I mean by phases is in basketball, everybody's trying to emulate the Golden State Warriors. They're trying to build their team as the Golden State Warriors.
Like a super team.
You understand what I'm saying?
Okay.
Not even necessarily
not a super
that.
Team.
Just talking about everybody
team.
Wants to get 3-point shots.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to.
Oh,
go
okay,
run
okay.
Down,
oh, I got you. Yeah.
The,
NFL,
the game started
NFL,
with the
quick. They have this thing now. Now you got this dude, Sean McVay.
Uh-huh.
He used to be a Washington Redskins tight end coach.
Okay.
He went to the LA Rams. One of the youngest coaches ever. Now, ever since he's been there, the Rams have been knockouts.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So now, if you're an offensive coordinator and everybody sees you have a good season, your team is doing whatever, creating points and all that, now they want to take these people, which Pat Sherman was.
Mm.
He was an offensive coordinator for the Vikings. They did one good year. Then the Giants is like, oh, we got to get this guy.
But he wasn't their first option. Remember that
he wasn't the first.
They
option,
wanted. They wanted
the
dude from that's the Detroit Lions. They wanted him first, but they missed
Patricia,
out on him.
Patricia.
And then they missed out on somebody else, and then he was their third option.
But once again, also you could have went for somebody else. The only reason why they picked him was because of that season that he had. When they forget that he used to be the Cleveland Browns coach, and
My thing is that they should have never ever fired Coughlin. Never. Should have never did it.
Nah, they did the right thing, letting him go. They just, to me, their whole management is just garbage. Mm. From the GM down. Wow. And I hope he gets fired this year and we bring Mike McCarthy in. Mm. Need somebody reputable there, bro, because the play calling is just, I sit in my room and I call the plays.
Like, I mean, the Giants have big drops in that game. Evan Engram has had a big drop.
The defense is like, I can go out there and get 300 yards on these guys, man. It's just terrible, man.
Man, it's that bad. Shit. Wow.
Man, it's about as bad as the Yankees last night.
Throw them shots. Listen, I want to say this right now, and I want to throw my biggest shot of them all. Anybody who wants to talk shit about any kind of sports, especially about the Yankees, they could come see me on this show. I'm calling out anybody who's got any kind of craziness that I be saying some business, because I know there's a lot of Yankee fans that's probably listening and like, man, this dude needs to shut the hell up. Invite you on here.
How do you have merit to do that when your team sucks?
Because I love the back and forth, man. I love the game. I love the cat and mouse. Stop crying, Nelly. You looking real.
Not only do we have a bum coach, and I don't like to say ifs, but I'm going to say it right now. Bro, we had the best second half of the season of any team.
Yeah, you're right. No,
if we had a coach that knew the game, we would have went into the playoffs, bro.
Yeah, you're right. They were real close. They were real close.
You understand what I'm saying?
They came short on the wild card race, for sure.
Classic Mets shit, though. Yeah, bro. Like, look right now. Instead of getting Joe Girardi, they're going to pick a bum. Watch.
Wow.
Anyways, NBA starts Tuesday?
Actually looking at the site right now.
Yeah. NBA starts Tuesday.
We're going to see. Well, we got a tradition, me and John Tavar. Yeah. We kind of broke it last year, I think, right? Because we were like, fuck the Knicks. We hate them and shit. But now, you know, they look kind of hopeful. They might be a 6 or 7 seed.
Somebody please turn my headphones off so I
don't have to hear. You're a Nets fan. Now.
You're a Mets and Nets.
Which one is mine so I can take this off?
That me and John Tavar, we got a tradition.
Yeah.
That we always watch the first game here in this crib. Yeah. So you're more than welcome to come. So you can talk your Nets shit. You know what I'm saying?
I'm not a Nets fan, my brother.
What's the team?
I'm a Bulls fan.
Are you one of those days?
I don't want to throw up on the table while we're watching this game. Like, I appreciate the hospitality.
How the Bulls looking like for this season, though? So
looking better than the Knicks.
You think so?
Relax.
We got a squad. Listen,
it's the same thing with any team. Mm-hmm. If the top isn't doing his job, it doesn't matter what they put on the floor. That's why the Knicks suck and Chicago suck.
Yeah.
Because their front office sucks.
That's true, though. So, you're right about that.
You know,
right.
Me being a Bulls fan, I just accept it.
You accept it.
Like, listen, man, I know we're probably going to be subpar.
Right.
I'll accept it because until a change gets done up top, that's why I respect the Yankees. Yeah. I don't like them, but you got to respect Brian Cashman for doing it for over 20 years.
So being hopeful is not good? Like, you can't be hopeful?
For who?
For any team.
I mean, you could be hopeful in life.
Oh, my God.
But not to be a hopeful Knicks fan. Like,
oh, my God.
Tank, listen, man. Tank is one of those rare dudes that the first time we met, it's like we became brothers, but now he's disappointing me, man. You know, he's disappointing me, man. I got to rethink my analysis about Tank because he's over here. He's throwing up on the Knicks. What's going on, man?
If anybody messes with all New York teams, I feel sorry for you, man. All you got going for you is the Yankees, man. Like, for real. Let's be serious. Right.
Shout out to the Islanders. Hockey.
Oh, yeah. Islanders and the Rangers.
Too. The Rangers ain't that, you know.
The Rangers and the Islanders is nice too, but who really watches hockey?
That's the whole thing that always boggles me. Like, Dolan has always done a good job with the Rangers, and then with the Knicks, bro, is like shitty.
That's crazy. Can I say something real quick, man? Bodega got on the bluest Dominican shirt or sweater I've ever seen.
Dominican Power, baby. You got that.
In my life.
Hey, man. Two-time for the May up there. He got that. Support those who support you.
He got that.
Dominican Power.
He got that Mike Jones DP. DP from Degman, the Mayor Degman shirt. Mike Jones, baby. Shout out to Mike Jones from Degman Basketball, man. Making big moves all the time, bro.
So we got the Chile situation now going on.
So in Chile. So in Chile, there's been declared a state of emergency because of a fare increases in public transportation.
Right, right.
As always, the young people, the college kids, high school kids are the ones out in the streets causing chaos because, you know, they're the future. So
absolutely.
They're really going through it right now, and the country is in turmoil, and the government is scared because these guys are really going in.
Right, right. They're really going in, yeah. Because, I mean, the power is always in numbers, though, man. It's good to see young people like that getting together and fighting something that, you know, I mean, should be changed because, I mean, again, it's a lot of corruption involved in government, every government. It's always corruption, you know what I'm saying?
But, you know, changes always come from the young, you know? Like, if you look at the Vietnam War, it was always the college protesters that was out there fighting a good fight, you know?
No, absolutely,
so. I just want to know why, like you mentioned, chaos. Like, I don't believe when you out there trying to fight for something that you believe in is chaos. Mm. Chaos comes from those opposed.
Yeah,
which
yeah.
Which are the guards, which are the military and stuff like that. Those are the ones that throw in the chaos.
You're right about that, yeah.
Because once people come in a peaceful manner, you understand what I'm saying? They always try to bring force against that.
Yes.
And that's where the chaos comes in.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah,
It's throughout history you can
see
that.
About that.
You feel me? That's so true. It's like, you know, what's the human right for anyway?
Yeah, so, I mean, listen, I've always been a fan of, like, I mean, I believe that once things get out of control, you're supposed to protest violent, you know, with violence. That's the only way the government does something about it. Then that all that like peaceful protest shit does not work. This is why people are fed up. They try to do it peacefully. It doesn't work. Now you continue to fuck them up the ass by increasing fares for public transportation, by increasing education costs, by increasing the cost of living. Like, what are they supposed to do? Are they supposed to not retaliate? You know what I mean? Like, what the fuck is going on?
Now you retaliate.
I mean, they're retaliating now. I mean, they should have done.
How you retaliate, man.
How do you retaliate?
Violence is not the issue.
Okay.
Violence against violence is just going to make more
violence. More violence, yeah.
And it's not going to make anything at the end.
But it will bring things to a middle ground.
Hold on.
Okay.
It will resolve nothing.
Okay.
You understand what I'm saying? The only way that you can go at your government is by hitting them where it hurts them. And where is that? The economy.
Yep.
In their pockets.
Yeah.
So now this is what you do. Oh, you dudes don't want to do this? Yo, listen, nobody get on that train.
Boycott.
Nobody use this bus. Nobody use any type of transportation.
Right, right.
That these people, until a change is made.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Bro, are you crazy?
But you know, in the midst of that, violence gets created because they're sending out the police and the state, they're sending out the National Guard to stop these people from doing stuff, right? And then they react, and then it starts.
But it leads to nothing, is what I'm trying to tell you.
Yeah.
You feel me?
Yeah.
Like, if people would really sit back and understand and look at everything from a different view.
Yeah.
First of all, you're not going to get everybody on the same page.
Yeah. Right.
There's always going to be somebody in there that's going to be wanting to be a protagonist to whatever you're trying to do.
Right, right.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Or antagonist, excuse me.
Yeah, antagonist.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, until you can get a group to be like, listen, like, in prison.
Yeah.
You know the biggest thing that people could do in prison to change something is not eat their food?
Not right, go to right, chow. Don't go to chow.
Don't go to motherfucking lunch. Don't go to
breakfast. Don't go to chow, baby.
Don't go to dinner. Now everybody's like, yo, what the fuck is going on?
Right,
why is
right.
nobody coming through to eat?
Right, right.
Don't nobody use the phone? Because you want to know why? That's how they make their money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
That's
Once
right.
you stop allowing them to make
right
money,
that.
Now it's like, hold on, man. Y'all bugging out right now.
Yeah, yeah.
What's
right,
up?
Right.
We need to sit down.
Right,
oh,
right.
now you want to sit down.
Right, right.
You understand what I'm saying?
You're right about that. I mean, it means.
But that's the whole thing. And Chetty, they started like that. And
then it's not going to work.
They want they're doing a combination of both things. Violent protest and that fucking up the economical system. You know what I mean? They're doing it both ways. They're fed up. There's been too many things going on in the history of the last 20 years. They've been fucked up the ass, the public, and they're tired.
Yeah, so like either country shit.
They've done the stuff like that, and it's worked for a little while, and it goes back to the same thing. So now they're fighting power with power. And
I would say though, man, and you're right about that, because I'm thinking about like the civil rights movement, how that really worked, boycotting the buses, and how they got the attention of the people. Because at the end of the day, knowing that, you said it right, you nailed it with the economy. You got to hit them where it hurts. And the economy is where it really hurts them. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And we want people, us, the general public, we're the one that actually makes the economy run.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? So we are the ones that have actual power. You know what I'm saying? Because the people, I mean, most people don't understand this though, but the people in power are not more powerful than the power of the people.
At all.
You know what I'm saying?
First of all, it's more of us than them.
Exactly. We are the majority. you know what I mean? So, it's just like, man, but it's like you said, though. It's a lot of lack of education. And again, at the same time, you know, saying to look at both sides, yes, it could be very frustrating where sometimes it does get a little bit violent. People just start snapping because, like, you know, they just
fed up because they've tried other methods and it hasn't worked.
Right, right.
So what are they going to result to? They're just going to sit there and continue to get fucked, or they're going to do something about it?
I think it's really planning things out where, man,
all revolutions lead to violence anyway. All that other shit is great. But at the end of the day, when nothing is getting resolved, guess what? People are going to turn violent, and they're going to take it out on...
But once the dust clears, everything is going to stay the same.
Yeah, it's true, though.
Sometimes it has, because if you think about it...
The majority of the times...
Revolutions have changed the situations. Revolts.
Not many.
A lot.
Not many.
A lot. Nowadays it hasn't, because people are pussy. They don't go out there and do that shit. They don't go out there and fight. In Europe and in these countries, they go out there and they fight. They do not care about dying. They don't care about what's going to happen the next day. They care about what's going to happen in the future. You know what I'm saying?
But you got to understand, though, you can't compare those situations, because right now
you're in America, protesters are pussies.
Yeah, but listen to what I'm saying, though. You got to understand, you're speaking about a third world situation as opposed to an American situation. Speaking of the United States, there's way more things in the United States than there is in Chile. So it's easy for a person in the United States to be like, fuck it, that shit don't affect my life.
Yeah, because they're more worried about watching Love and Hip Hop. They don't want to die before that episode comes.
They can get whatever, is what I'm saying. Yeah. They can get public assistance. They can get help from this person. A person in Chile ain't getting help from nobody.
That's the way that they...
You know what I'm saying? So, of course, they're going to go... Nigga, this is all I got. I'm going till I die.
At least
somebody behind me gonna get it. America is never gonna be like that.
Yeah, because people are so reliant on, fuck that. I could get this and get that. Fuck the next nigga.
That's what I'm saying.
Over there, they're like, no.
You can't compare them.
Fuck that. We're gonna work for our future. Our kids gotta be good.
Yeah.
And America's pussy when it comes to that. Citizens, they're pussy when it comes to that.
Well, I think it's just because many of them are just not really informed and they're just so...
Because they're brainwashed through the welfare system, through these programs that help them. Oh, you're poor? Guess what? You can get public assistance and you can live a decent life or a semi-decent life. No.
Right. It's experiences, man.
Yeah.
Unless a person's back is against the wall, a lot of people in America don't know what their back against the wall means.
Yeah. Right,
people in third world country have lived this since they were born.
Absolutely.
So it's a different mindset.
You know what I'm saying?
So that's why I said you can't necessarily say that about Americans, even though Americans, like I said, they have a lot more things that third world countries don't have to offer. And they could just sit back and be like, man, fuck that. I don't care.
You know
what I'm saying?
I mean, the way that America is going... The road that America is going down right now, it might end up like that in the future, where people are just tired and end up doing the same things they do in these countries.
They've been beating my people and killing my people for centuries, man, and we still ain't get together.
Still being oppressed, man.
Hey, man, shout out to Dinner the Round Table, man. They got this hot, banging lasagna up in the oven, baby. I'm hungry, baby. I'm starving,
baby.
I'm
ready. But they get a DJ, man.
We gotta get him more involved.
Your fans want to know, like, what do you think about what's going on in the world and in Chile with the violent protests? You think that's the way? Is this what they want?
Hey, man, I think them shots answered it. I think that was already enough said, right?
Oh my God, man.
Yeah. So I mean,
what can I say in America? Man, I always gotta let the one and only talk, man. Agent Zero, where you at? Agent Orange
in the building. How you doing there, Mr. President?
What's going on here, guys? How you doing?
Well, we gotta
get a... Gotta give me a clap, man.
Welcome back, as I always do.
I wasn't here last week, and I was trying to fight, you know, everybody saying that they want to have the G7 summit at my resort, you know. I want all the money, man. I want every dollar, bro.
Man.
And they don't want to give me the dollars, man, but I had to come, you know, after I resolved it, and I was like, you know what, man, I'm all right. You know, I don't want all the money. I do want all the money, but I want all the money.
So, Mr. President, obviously you use our tax dollars to come here every week.
Of course, on Air Force 2, man. I got to come on Air Force 2.
So we know that.
Of course, man. Of course, I got to come on Air Force 2.
You've been skimming. You've been skimming.
Of course, man. You know, I got the Secret Service outside.
But,
you know, they got JT's location on,
Agent Orange.
Secret.
Chile is protesting violently now.
It's not going to happen here, buddy, right? Because my people... are great people, you know? They make America beautiful. You know, even though nobody wants to come to my resort and spend all the money, give me all the money. That's all I want, bro. That's all I want is my money, man. Give me my money. That's all I want is my money.
That's all they want.
You know, but, you know, so it's all right. It's never going to happen here because America's great. We look out for each other.
You're saying that it's not going to happen here
because
America...
Because we're great, buddy.
Because you have made America great since...
Of course. Since I've been president, you know, the wall's been built in my mind and my dreams. You know, I saw somewhere on the internet that, you know, they said, what if Mexico builds stairs on the other side to go on, you know, to go over the ball? But it's not going
to
happen because I'm going to have my snipers and they're going to shoot bullets of love.
Oh, my God.
You know, I love all my people. That's why I want to build a wall over there. So
you're not against Latinos coming over?
I'm not, man.
Or Mexicans.
I just want to build the wall because I just want to. Okay. I don't even know why. I mean, I only say that because
so
there's people...
So you have an infatuation with...
Of course. Basically. I just have an infatuation with building things that I will never pay for.
Orange, how's that Spanish coming along?
Estoy bien? I don't know, buddy. You know what I'm going to have? You know, when I win the presidency, I'm going to have Bodega DJ my inauguration, bro. Because he's my biggest fan. He always comes through with the music when I come on. Oh, you know? Man.
So when you get elected for a second term...
Bodega's going to be there, buddy.
DJ at the White House, bro.
Yeah, man.
And you're gonna send Air Force 2 to pick him up and
Air Force 3. Air Force 3. And you know, I'm gonna pay him about $200 in pesos.
Yes.
He's gonna get $200 an hour in pesos.
What is your favorite meal?
Dominican pesos, I think.
What is your favorite meal in the McDonald's menu? Because Agent Orange, that's his specialty. Providing McDonald's.
Well, he said there's fries and with Taco Bell.
With extra sauce, extra cheese, and throw some bacon on that thing.
You're going to get extra bacon, buddy, right? You're going to get paid $200 in pesos an hour, right? Wow. How's that sound, buddy, right? That's a lot of money.
There you go. Dinner at the Roundtable Podcast.
Yes, Agent Orange
in
the building.
I might have to vote for him after that one.
Yeah, man.
We'll take. You know, they sent me a digital copy of your book, and you know, I was sitting in the Oval Office reading it while I should have been doing some work, but I wasn't. Because it was such a great and like
you was busy on Twitter probably.
Yeah. And I was on Twitter, man. I sent the cryptic text.
I am
because I love all the monies.
So what do you think about Mr. Taino Domingo's book here?
It's amazing, buddy. It's amazing. It's a great thing.
What are you doing to prevent the HIV epidemic?
I got a cure for it.
Oh, you know,
you
have a cure.
I got the cure for AIDS, buddy. You know that?
Are you saying
it? I got the cure for AIDS. And you know what? You know what? You know what, Mr. Domingo? I want you to be an advocate. I want you to come work for me in the White House. Be one of my advisors. And then in about 3 months, I'll fire you, all right? Does that sound good? You know, I'm like, you know, I'm going to go have a press conference and say, I'm introducing to you my new advocate, Taino Domingo, and then 3 months later, you're going to get fired.
That's crazy, man.
I love your book, but it's amazing. Oh. Yes. But like I said, I want all the money.
If you fire him, he might be
vengeful. I want all the money, Nelly. Give me all the money.
Oh, man.
If you fire him, he might
come
be vengeful.
Come to my G7 resort. I want all the money. I want to get all the world leaders there. I want all the money. Because I'm the Don, buddy. I'm the Don.
Yes, you are the Don.
I am the Donald.
Do you want him to be vengeful if you fire him? Because he might be vengeful.
He might be vengeful. He might come in, you know, I don't know.
The title of his book.
Vengeful. Maybe. It might happen.
Oh my God.
But like I said, I'm the Don. Yeah. All right? I do what I want. You know? He's going to be there for 3 months. And then he's going to be gone. Right.
Get him. Oh, man.
Like, I fire everybody. Everybody works for me for about 6 months. I get tired of him. I'm like, hey, you know, I don't want you anymore. But like I said, I want all the money. Before I go, I want to say, give me all the money. Come to my resorts. Round the tabs.
Yes.
It's a benefit, man. You get A1 service? You're not going to get A1 service. You might get A7, A8, maybe, you know?
Oh, my God.
You won't get A1. You might get A7, all right? But anyways, you know, it's Agent Orange, as always, came to my spot. My Secret Service agents are telling me to hurry up because I got to go back to the White House.
Thanks for coming by.
Like I said, it was great because they sent me a copy of your book because I'm like the fifth host of the book. It was nice meeting you. You know, you'll be getting a call from my secretary soon. I hope you answer. It's the Don signing out.
Agent Orange,
thank you for coming again, buddy. We'll see you next week.
So,
real quick before we advance, The FBI has concluded their their reports on the whole Dominican Republic thing, the deaths that were going on.
Oh, yeah? So what was the whole thing?
And they've concluded that they were all calls to natural causes.
Oh, wow.
All the tourist deaths were natural causes. They died of natural causes.
I know Tekashi 6ix9ine's a rap, but he has some shit called stupid.
Yeah, so the FBI.
Of course it was.
Toxicology reports, autopsies, and everything concluded that the people who passed away during that time when the whole thing blew up about tourism in the Dominican Republic,
right.
that they actually died of natural causes. So, boom, to all y'all big
stupid
media fuckers
haters. Because that shit was stupid, man.
It was really stupid.
And then, you know what's the funny thing about it, though? It was the hot topic for like 2 months, and then you heard anything?
Yeah.
And then, but Bodega and JT were in DR recently, and, you know, they came back fine.
Yeah, they came back fine.
They came back super good, and they were in resorts chilling. You know, I saw Bodega with his Indiana Jones. And
one thing that Bodega did come back with was a big appetite, because he ate Mammoth Cervella Sticks last time.
Yo, shout out to the chef we got over here. Did it the wrong time.
Yeah, man. But anyway, toxicology tests done by the FBI have confirmed that the three American tourists found dead this spring that just passed in the Dominican Republic died of natural causes. The United States Department has declared.
All that started with that lady that got beat up.
Yes, she made a bad rap for it.
And they had a field day with that shit. Yeah, it wasn't started from that.
I think that was before her.
No, it started after.
No, she started that before.
Yeah, right. She was the first one. And then
these things were happening right
trickled
after.
Because then you had the couple that got run off the road
from Jersey.
Who were heading home. Yeah, they were heading home, but they were like super fucking drunk.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know? And then you can't drive in DR super drunk because they're crazy and they have no regard. I would never ever drive in DR.
Propaganda is real big. It makes you wonder what the agenda really was. So the lady started the whole thing, right? With getting beat up by somebody who works in one of the resorts.
Then
the couple gets ran over the road, right?
No, they got off the road.
Then the tourists start dying, right?
Yeah.
Then you start to think, was there a bigger agenda? Was there a company that was trying to focus tourism somewhere else? So they used that opportunity?
It was a conspiracy.
It was a conspiracy.
Yeah, I mean,
It was the birth of Barcelona Chris. That episode was the birth of Barcelona Chris.
Check this out. That was the birth of Barcelona Chris.
For a marketing genius, that would have been the perfect opportunity to... Because the Dominican Republic is number two in tourism in the world.
Number two
in the world in tourism.
Hell yeah.
In the world. Number two in the world. Number two. Not number one, number two.
And it could be the number one. I mean, that's without a doubt. That's evident.
Somebody who has an agenda to focus tourism somewhere else to make another destination popular could have taken advantage of that situation and stirred it up to make it look like they were making it look that it was bad to visit the Dominican Republic to steer people away from going there to make some other attraction more popular.
Right.
You know what I mean? That happens all the time.
There was an agenda, though. Like, I mean,
in marketing, people...
There was an agenda. I don't know what was the agenda, but there was an agenda. That makes evident because every major media outlet was just going with that story. Yeah. And just dogging DR. So obviously,
I mean, she did glorify that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That supposed... You know what I'm saying? Situation that happened.
Right.
But
you see that all the time where two companies are competing against each other, they defame each other, they do commercials dissing each other. That's part of marketing. They do that. So,
of course.
What does it say that they weren't doing it with this? With tourism? Tourism is one of the biggest businesses in the world.
It is.
Why not do it? You know what I'm saying? How many times doesn't AT&T talk shit about Sprint on TV? Like, right in your face. It happens. You know what I mean? Like, there's people with big money that support these businesses. They're are willing to dish in the extra money to make somebody else, the competition, slander look bad. Yeah, slander them. And it happens. You see it in political debates. You see it all the time.
Mm-hmm. No, you're right.
See it in the streets. You see it at work. You get a position, and there's a co-worker who's been there 5 years. You're longer than you. And he tell you because you got a position.
And that's one of the things we're gonna cover too. The hating ass bitch ass niggas.
Yeah. So that happens. So imagine
there's a lot of that.
So imagine if that's happening at a smaller level. Imagine when the big boys is playing with big money. They're gonna do all they can to make sure that their system keeps on working. You know what I mean?
Yo, I just want to say that this is the first time I've actually seen Nelly so excited, and he got the JT eyes going on over there.
Oh, shit.
He's like, oh, you know,
Oh, yeah, man. But let's
we're talking about real life situations.
I know. That's all right, though.
Cutting meat in the back of a
I know. It's cutting meat. But, yo, man, you know, I just want to point out the fact.
Dicing and slicing is not
I just want to point out the fact that it now took like 20 minutes to put his headphones on.
Dicing,
today. He was
trying to fix his hair. Because
he got the perfect hairline. Son.
But listen,
yo, my man.
Let's take a quick break,
man.
Let's go pay some bills now. Then we come back. We go spot.
There's more to life than dicing and slicing. That's all.
And there's more to life than a perfect hairline. You heard me?
You're right. There is more than that.
You bet. Because you be slicing and dicing on the ones and twos.
But a perfect hairline would give you a lot of bitches, though. I'll tell you
I bet it was. But right now, we're about to go to Bodega as he slices and dices as the ones and twos, baby.
Yeah. Then at the round table with Taino Domingo.
Cheers.
Is on the set and he's here to shut shit down.
Shot a bass, she gon' bust it down. She know about them digits in my bank account. And she love the way I do it when I'm in it. Be it every time I come to town. Shot a bass, she gon' bust it down. She know about them digits in my bank account. And she love the way I do it when I'm in it.
From the LBC show, wheels up on the G4. Louis bag with the Gucci loafs, silk shirt with a mink coat, flying in, selling game to all you hoes and y'all buying in, legend in your presence, got a room full of bitches and they lying there, high in there, ain't no fire but a lot of wine there, you get it, ain't no Wi-Fi, on the low, close the door, bitch, I spy, see when I pull up, jump in, we slip out, roll up, roll out, get mine, step out. She had to come and give a real crip a taste. Out of pocket, never that stay in a stripper's place. Big round ass with some fat titties. And baby, make magic when I'm in the city.
Every time I come to town, shot a bad, she gon' bust it down. She know about them digits in my bank account. And she love the way I do it when I'm in it. But yeah, every time I come to town, shot a bad, she gon' bust it down. She know about them digits in my bank account.
Like damn, not even basketball's bouncing like that. Still do it. support for my projects. Yeah. Still winning, I ain't lose my project. Nah. Old Town Road for my projects. Huh? Ride till I can't no more, little Nas X. Yeah, we the heroes to the zeros. Where I come from, they don't hear those other widows. We the ones who represent them, not Shapiro's. We they favorite gangsters, nah, not De Niro. If you play it, you ask, till we okay, relax. I'm so Brooklyn, my nigga, if I say it, it's facts. If I made, I backs. If I roll, I race. Like every day is Christmas, I got the coldest toys. Told my boys, 10 toes, hold your poise. For the biggest comeback, work the soldier boy. Yeah, I slide out like polar boys. Yeah, I'm outside with the oldest boys. Yeah, I tell you when my best hold the voice. I can move in a room full of soldiers, boy.
That work hit different when it's raw. That box hit different when it's raw. My grip hit different when it's raw. My stick hit different when it's raw. It hit different. 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 That work hit different when it's raw. That box hit different when it's raw. My drip hit different when it's on. My stick hit different when it's raw. It hit different. 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 When that light hit these diamonds in my chain, then watch it hit different. They ain't lit lit when we get lit. Shit different. Fuck a buck 50, that's 300. They cut you different. When you up, up, these hoes be fucking you different. This dope I got is a 20, it hit different. Like when you gang affiliated, get convicted. Ask any chick I ever hit, this dick different. It's like pills and nicotine, how they get addicted. 450, tucked in a merry dinner. When these bullets got your name on it, it hit different. Leg side versus hand side is a big difference. When the real nigga make a hit, it hit different. That work hit different when it's raw. That box hit different when it's raw. My drip hit different when it's on. My stick hit different when it's wrong. It hit different. 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 It hit different.
Out here, whole Nino Browns done turned pookie out here. No cool niggas, it's just goofies out here. I mean, niggas is eating pork wearing koofies out here. Through it all, stood tall, doofy out here. 10 toes down, I'm on 2 feet out here. Truthfully out here, I'll be toothfully out here. Getting fly, no bullshit, I'm the 2-3 out here. From Jordans, you ain't see. Shout out to Carolina, to all baby me's. I see all you Harrimanas. Mixtape 3-peats, I fade away at the go-go. With girls that'll spread their legs open for a logo. Hey, check out the swag, yo, I walk like a ball player to the locker room. I'm back to cockatoo. Toast to all you niggas that was talking cockatoo. We on a different flow, we ain't sending vodka to them. The shots that we giving make you send a doctor to them. Betty say ah when it block a block a tune. Now he in an awkward room trying to lock a goon. Like the shooter had a hood on, might have been Dr. Doom. Sounded like a fifth or a nine, couldn't tell. All of a sudden thunder, it might have been Hoodie Mellow. You soft as pudding jello, would come to your hood and hello. Waving at everybody, ain't trying to be putting jello. All I know is that the Lambo look good in yellow. And I be swerving potholes in every hood and ghetto. Lame nigga, swerve, I lame nigga, swerve. It's been 10 years and you the same nigga, swerve. I just gotta keep on keeping on. But I'm not gonna be the one you keep on sleeping on. This verse right here be your worst nightmare. I just laugh at you niggas, then come after you niggas, Freddy.
Is this what you want?
Go, nigga. Go,
nigga. Dead wrong, you wanna live, I can't let you. You at full speed, I'm walking, I still catch you. Yeah. Mr. Voyes, good looking, I destroy these. These niggas ain't bosses, they workers and employees. I came out of the lake, but I be in the boondocks. Flannel or overall, work boots, tube socks. I put something right through your face from out the toolbox. Niggas get hot and make the news, I make the news hot. You can be as hard as whoever, I crack craniums. You know all my killings are brutal and spontaneous. I like this, pop out soon as you hit the light switch. Running, then all of a sudden you fall. Like the white chicks, might have to crush your Adam's apple with the vice grips. You never see me during the day, I play the night shift. Cartilage, flesh and bone, damn gristle. Yeah. Be my guest, go ahead and hide, I can't miss you. You already know I reside at Camp Crystal. Yeah. Lake, dismantle your face, revamp tissue. Damn. Power from the hockey mask, James St. Patrick. Three bodies in one night, that's a hat trick. Pay the plug soon as you finish, that's a backflip. Spend six, make 12 back, that's a crack flip. Sad part about it, you boys ain't even ready. Preferably my weapon of choice is the machete. Yeah. Screaming at the top of your lungs before I mangle you. Zip you up in your sleeping bag before I strangle you. Yeah, I had it in me since a youngin'. When you hear that, You don't see me, but I'm coming. Everybody gotta die. Every man, every woman. It ain't even no sense in running. My name ring around the nation. How the crime scene was left, they could tell that it was Jason.
Frízate cuando yo frene la zona. Si te hago un corito, tu corona. Ponme la medalla, voy a ser tu campeona. Stepping on these bitches, quieren mi corona. Están haciendo brujería, pero no funciona. Nunca malo coro, yo nunca he sido lambona. Y estas chamaquitas me miran y no reaccionan. Me miran y no reaccionan, pero digo, pistola tengo como él. Y sobran la pacate 100. Antes andaba peor en un Mercedes Benz. Y de tu coro yo te clara quién es quién. Dice que soy de nananina, son los calentona. La perra más fina por mi cuarto yo la parto. Mando par de tigres pa' que hagan un asalto. Mi nivel de nota siempre anda alto. Anda alto, anda alto, anda alto.
Opacamo tu demo. Opacamo tu demo. Yo no copio ni imito, compa, yo supero. Tienes que hacer saludo al movimiento entero. Llegué de último, pero soy de los primeros. Desde cuando se rapeaba en un aguacero en cuero. Mi mente bancaria es como la de un pelotero. Cuando llegue a ese nivel, la macaron un compañero. Ningún disculpa, eso es lo que quiero. Mi familia confortable y mi clan entero. Free, free, pa' todos los carceleros. Usted sabe verdad a lo que me refiero. Yo, tigre rapero, capo jolopero. Si fumó, si se dio, si es craquero. Son discípulos del mundo en el verdadero guero. Esa banda no suena bien sin el guirero. No. Y el que sabe todos los códigos de este es el velero. El mundo va a saber de mí, Dios lo dijo y ese es el primero, 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 primero. El mundo va a saber de mí, va a saber de mí. Ese es el primero, 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 primero. El mundo va a saber de mí, va a saber de mí.
Yo no estoy en pana, yo estoy en cuca. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Tú no eres de lo mío, deja tu mediante. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Jalapeño, spice, picante, picante. Tú no eres de lo mío, deja tu mediante.
Jalapeño, 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 jalapeño.
De los leños que llegan los jalapeños, te pegaron el muchacho, pero yo sí que la preño. Levanten la mano todos los capitaleños que llegaron los trabajos donde los puertorriqueños.
The Bodega the DJ is on the set, and he's here to shut shit down. Shut shit down. Shut shit down.
Nadie goza como yo. Nadie goza como yo.
Caliente.
Nadie goza como yo.
caliente.
Las traiciones se pagan con
Yeah, we're back. You got the Roundtable Podcast. I'm your DJ, John Tavall. Willie Nell, Chris Spider, but they get a DJ with our special guest, writer, author, Taino Domingo, man.
Yes,
so
sir.
Welcome again, man.
Sugar Hill, baby.
That's right, man. That's right, man.
So, you know, I want to talk about, you know, the dynamics and how life works. Last week, his boy Mayhem was on the show.
Yeah.
Killed it on his freestyle.
Killed it, man.
You know, but we had a nice little off camera conversation with Ten because he was in the studio audience,
right.
And then you know the conversation just came out organically, and we started talking about you know the various things, and that's when you know he came out talking about a book that he had, and then from there, you know he was you know how he came about it, and then the next day I believe he hit you up, you know, and brought us three copies. You know, and then, you know, life works out. And, you know, here at Dinner at the Roundtable Podcast, we definitely promote independence.
Absolutely.
And for the first time, I can honestly say that we have an author on the show.
Our first author.
And I can tell you from, you know, when I picked up my copy and I started reading it, you know, it captivated me because, you know, I'm not a big, you know, I only read, like, sci-fi novels and, you know, stuff like that. Like, you know, I'm really big on that and fantasy, but, you know. But, you know, I'm not really into, like, the whole, romance and drama and all that stuff. I'm not really into that. But this book was definitely something that captivated me, and I was hooked on it. I was like, oh.
Wow.
You know, and it was just the dynamic of it. And, you know, I can honestly say that me and this brother, we ain't know each other from a hole in the wall before last week. And, you know, we had a couple conversations, and, you know, sometimes that, you know, you get that brotherhood right away.
Absolutely.
With some people.
You click quickly, man.
You know, and I'm definitely proud to have this brother on the show.
Yes, man. Taino Domingo, man.
Tank Domingo, man. Or Taino Domingo, author of Vengeful.
Yeah, man.
Yes, sir.
Talk about it, brother.
Let's talk about it. I mean, what the idea came from, though? Like, just start with that, though. Like, what actually made you want to write a book?
So, the idea, well, while I was in prison, I was involved in this, with this prison organization.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not really organization, but program called PACE. And PACE pretty much stands for Prisoners for AIDS Counseling Education.
Okay.
And it stands for what it is. Pretty much what it is any individuals coming inside the prison, you know, there's orientation. And in that orientation, I will go there and I will give about an hour of presentation about the HIV and AIDS virus.
Oh, okay.
You understand what I'm saying? Because as we know, you know, there are people living risky behaviors in prison.
Right, right.
So
yeah,
we're trying to let them know, like, listen, you can live this risky behavior, but just know that you're behind the eight ball.
Wow.
And every time you perform one of these risky behaviors, any day could be the day you crap out.
Man.
And then, you know, there's somebody that with three letters or four letters that's going to be waiting for you.
Wow.
You understand what I'm saying? So pretty much like I said, I did that for so many years. And just one evening, I went to sleep, had a dream, woke up and had a book.
Wow. Damn.
You know what I'm saying? Pretty much
it's
like
crazy
that.
Crazy how they came out, man. Damn.
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely. What God does, man.
Wow.
Because it ain't me. Believe that. All the people that know that I wrote it,
right?
Well, like Mayhem, he said, man, there's a dude coming out a couple years gonna say that he wrote that and you just stole it from him. You know what I'm saying?
Oh man, that's crazy though, man. I mean, I read the book, but I got to chapter 3 still though. I mean, I still haven't read the full book entirely, obviously, but I like the beginning though, with the attorney, right? And I like the whole Washington Park intro too though.
Yeah, that was pretty dope that he did that though. And you know, and the one thing about the book is like he goes into very vivid details about certain things because you know, as a writer myself, I know me and Tank had conversation. I was talking to him about the book that I wanted to write. It's all about painting a picture for somebody because it's different from a movie. Mm-hmm. Whereas a movie, it's visual, it's in your face. But as a book, you really have to paint the picture within someone's mind. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you're introducing a character, you have to really have the person visualize exactly how they look.
Absolutely.
And what you want to portray that person to look. And so one thing that I was very impressed with the book was that how he came into very vivid details on how the characters he wanted to present actually looked.
Right.
You know, and then he introduced their personalities, their mannerisms, how they came off.
Right.
The energy that they portrayed.
Right.
And especially, and then the dynamic of the book that I really liked because I've read, you know, the book in pretty much in its entirety. It was the fact of how he introduced three characters and he made the story intertwine within each other. And then it's really crazy how like the world is really small. Because you can meet somebody you never knew but can literally have lived a block away from you your entire life.
That's crazy, yeah.
You know, and then it was crazy how like, you know, and to me I always respect an author's mind because of how they can create a vivid world for another person to create that entertainment for them.
Right.
You know, if you think about some of the greatest authors in the world, you think about J.R. Tolkien, you think about George Lucas, you think about you know, all these people who've created such great vivid stories. It's all about a thought that you want to manifest.
Right.
You know, and then some, you know, it's like Kendrick Lamar said, it's like the biggest thing for me is to tell you and draw you into me in 16 bars. So how can I draw you into a story that you want to read? Because there's thousands and thousands and thousands of books that come out, you know, not only every week or every month, but in its entirety. How can you draw somebody in? And that's something that to me, when I read this book, is what I did. But he drew me into a vivid story, and it became a really good hood novella.
Dropped the book, right?
Yeah, it was a hood novella to me, you know. It was a hood novella because he had like the he had the hood Spanish. He had the language with the mom, and then what I liked the most was that he did the lines in Spanish, and then in the bottom he'll have the translations for it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, okay, for the non-Spanish speaking people who are reading this book, they can understand. Okay, this is what she meant.
The non-Spanish speaking people, which include Chris Ryder.
I know some of it, motherfucker. All right.
We just had to make
you
sure
bitch ass nigga.
It hit everybody that I was trying to reach because at the end of the day, you know, the book is a little bit dated now.
Okay.
But the only reason why I say it's dated now because a lot of people don't know how intricate BT was with the whole HIV epidemic. Like they were an integral part and trying to put that out there for the masses. You understand? Every World's AIDS Day, which happens in December, they always had an event. They always had artists come through. They always had the whole audience wearing red, you know what I'm saying, to commemorate World AIDS Day. So that's why I opened and finished the book with it. Because I felt like, you know, they were really ahead of the ball when it came to that for our community.
Got you.
You know, the whole point of this book was for me to be able to give this information, but, you know, not teach it at the same time. I am teaching, but I'm disguising the teaching with the story. You understand what I'm saying? Because the true antagonist of the story, somebody will say, is who do you think is the antagonist since you read the book?
It was Susio.
You see? Mm. Me, the antagonist in this is HIV and AIDS.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah, okay, I see. Yeah.
See what I'm saying? Yeah. Everybody's going to get their own perspective.
Got you.
But
okay.
To me, once you read the book, you're going to realize, yo, this virus is crazy.
Yeah, this virus crazy. Can really change people's lives.
You understand what I'm saying?
Not absolutely. Only the person who's infected, but people around them.
Yeah,
just everything.
Yeah. And it comes back to tentacle. And it's so easy how, like, you know, how easy it can just spread. Because there's so many stupid people out there that, like, they see a beautiful woman and they think, oh, she's so beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, get them in the corner. She wants you, you want her. And, you know, we've all been there, drunk. Yeah, and then we had the opportunity where she's like, well, I don't got a condom, let's go get it. You don't know what you're sticking yourself into.
That's right.
You know, because then what is she, you know, like the main character. She had something. That homie didn't know what she had. He did it anyway. Because he was drunk and he was horny and she was bad.
Yeah.
And then that's a mistake. That's a mistake that he will live for the rest of his life because he let his dick
think for him. And yeah, man, it's just like HIV is called. It's called the human immunodeficiency virus. So it's kind of, you know, you could be transmitted through infected blood, semen, or vaginal fluids.
Right.
So it's a, you know what I'm saying, like, sexually, you know, sexual contact is probably the most common form, correct?
Right. Sharing needles.
Mr. Taino?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, so pretty much, you know, risky behavior could be a multiple of things, you know, but like Chris said, once a person is inebriated or just pretty much under the influence of something that's going to make a bad judgment.
Right.
You know, it's as simple as that.
And that's common,
you know what
though,
I mean? Because this is what I'm trying to tell you.
Yeah.
Like, people see it as, I wanted to say something what Chris said, but that's his opinion. It's not as stupid, as crazy as somebody might think.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Because pretty much, like I said, you could be out on a date and it's regular, and it's not somebody that you met in the club. It could be somebody that you've been trying to get with for a minute.
Yeah.
So that's true.
You get with an individual, and then next thing you know, one thing leads to another.
Right.
And you're so much in the moment
that you forget
in the moment, to be like, hold on, give me a second real quick.
You know, Tank, it's funny that you said that. I've been in situations where I've known the person for a little bit of time, and I've been in a situation where, like, you know what, let me take it off and let me do it raw. And then I think to myself, I don't know this person long enough to actually trust them.
You're going to give it to them raw, like, you know, cocaine from Bolivia?
Listen, first of all, unless you're both getting tested, I don't care how long you know a person.
Yeah.
Because I know individuals that have the virus. Mm. And you wouldn't know
a damn thing.
You wouldn't know right about that.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, literally. You feel me? So you can't even go by that. Like, right now, they got a stupid ass meme on Instagram going around that it says, I went into this chick raw, but I'm gonna go take a smoothie right now. Like, saying the smoothie's just gonna stop you from getting infected.
Oh my god,
that shit is crazy to me, man. Like, yo, I go crazy.
Have a green smoothie, you know?
Everything's gonna be all right.
You be good.
It's gonna be all right.
You know what I mean? So it's like, people don't really understand, like, this virus is. I don't want to get into the conspiracies and everything about that. I know my brother JT want to get into that.
Yeah.
He's big on that sort of thing.
I just know one thing for two things for certain.
Yeah.
This virus is not playing no games. Top of that, it's very intricate. When I mean intricate, like, I have a chart that I was going to show you guys. Like, listen, the process of an HIV infecting a cell, first of all, HIV, what it does is it seeks out people's white blood cells. Now, unless anybody doesn't know, a white blood cell is pretty much is the army in your body.
Okay.
It fights off any foreign invaders that come inside your body. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? So pretty much whenever you get a flu shot, it's your white blood cells that goes to that and then hits everybody up and be like, yo, listen, we got this foreign invader, go at this section and take them out. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So what the virus does, it latches on to the white blood cell. You know what I'm saying? Then it goes inside the white blood cells and it starts changing the white blood cells. Mm. It brings in a protein that's called RNA. You know what I'm saying? Which is the virus. And what it does, it infiltrates the white blood cell
and turns it from DNA to RNA, so then it comes back and it affects the other white cells because they see it as the same. Mm. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. So they copy.
This is how intricate this virus is.
Man.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's way deeper than people really think it is. You know what I'm saying? So now it's disguised as a white blood cell. So it's like
it infiltrates the rest of the
way. The way I used to break it down in prison was, let's just say right now we all got greens on. You know what I'm saying? If an officer wants to come inside this room and listen to what they talking about, what we talking about, what are they gonna do? They're gonna take their blue uniform on and put on a green uniform and come in and sit in the class. Then walk back outside and put their blue uniform on and be an officer all over again, and then tell, yo, listen, this is what they was in there speaking about. You understand what I'm saying? Wow. So that's pretty much what the virus does.
Got you.
It goes in as an undercover agent, then infiltrates, gets information, fucks up everybody else, brings it back out, says, this is how we're going to attack the rest of them.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah. So,
so pretty much also, one thing I also wanted to bring up was, there's always this misconception about HIV and AIDS. Like, people just...
Well, that's the virus that leads to AIDS, right? HIV?
Exactly. So it's a process. Mm-hmm. You know, for a person to be HIV and to progress to having AIDS, they have to have a CD4 T count level, which is another fancy word for white blood cells, 200 or less, or they have to have an opportunistic infection. Now, an opportunistic infection is pretty much like if a person has herpes or has any particular cancer or stuff like that, then automatically a person will be diagnosed as having AIDS. But if an individual doesn't have any one of those two, then you'll just be HIV positive.
Oh.
And now, you know, through a lot of research, and you know, it's been already almost 40 years that this virus has been out. You know, you got a lot of medicines out there that can help an individual while they have this virus. So it's not a death sentence like it used to be.
So let me ask you this. So you were saying about, like, it's only been 40 years. Think about how our parents were born, and we're in, like, young teenagers or even young adults before this virus was even an epidemic. Think about that for a second. So let's go into the actual history of it. Where did this virus come from?
Well, pretty much it's a lot of theories.
You know, they say it came from Africa with chimps and all that.
That's just...
Some people say it was bioengineered.
Well, the first main documented was... It was in Africa, but not necessarily the way people say it. But in the United States, it was... I don't know if y'all ever seen a movie called The Band Played On. But pretty much it was a flight attendant, a male flight attendant, who was positive. And he used to go to these gay speakeasies in San Francisco.
Oh.
And he used to have sex with individuals. So he was primarily the first one that was diagnosed to be giving people the virus. You understand what I'm saying? Back in the 80s. Wow. So then they started closing these speakeasies. But by the time they was closing it, people were getting infected. And not only were... It was gay people, but also, you know, you had people that was getting blood transfusions. So at that time, the people that was getting blood transfusions, they wasn't getting screened for the virus because
there was nobody knew about it.
Exactly. Nobody knew about it.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So it was this, I want to say, I'm not 100% sure if it was a congressman's wife that caught the virus due to blood transfusion. Wow. And then that just sparked the whole... Just the whole spectrum of HIV. Because
you got that famous movie Philadelphia that was about.
Yeah, but Philadelphia was fire. But if you really want to get to the crux of the beginning of
the
HIV, I would suggest anybody to go see And the Band Played On. It's an HBO movie, ton of awards in the 90s and stuff like that. And it's powerful, man. You know, I'm gonna just shoot this because. This is the vein that you was trying to go to.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But there's a book called Behold the Pale Horse.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, so in the book, they were speaking on how America was trying to do something similar as with China, you know, China has a
population control.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So pretty much they was trying to, the author was trying to say that the U.S. didn't know how to do population control.
Right, right.
So they had to invent something.
Right, right.
To stop the population.
Yeah.
You feel me?
Yeah, yeah.
So,
and I mean, the more I think about it, again, because I mean, the majority of people who actually infected here in the United States are blacks, you know, and to me that just rings bells. You know what I'm saying? I just try to, you know, think about, you know, try to put two together, you know, and I don't want to sound like a conspiracy, whatever, but I mean, I really believe that it is a man-made, you know, and it was basically targeted for a certain population. And the numbers, you see the numbers right now. And that's how I was being always skeptical about, you know, HIV. It's really a man-made disease and the effects it has on minorities, you know what I'm saying? So that's why I always, you know, thought about that though, man.
There's also a myth about that also.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the myth is due to back in the days with the plague.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, with the Caucasians and stuff like
right,
that.
Right, right.
There's a receptor that we all have. And because of that plague, supposedly the Caucasians don't have that same receptor that we have.
Oh,
which
wow.
is why we're more susceptible to getting it. But I'm not going to say whether that's true or
that's
not.
That's interesting.
But I'm just saying that because of what you're trying to imply and stuff like that. But right now, as it goes, man, you know, in the five boroughs, the Bronx is the most cases reported of having the most HIV cases reported right now.
Oh, in New York City?
In New York City.
Oh, wow.
Man.
That's crazy, man.
You know, it's, you know, it's only thing I could say, man, is be careful with who you with and whoever you with. Just,
that's right. No,
you
definitely.
Know, put your foot down and be like, and I'm not going to sit here and be like I'm perfect. Like, I got caught slipping one time, you know, and me, I know there's a window period, you know, between 2 to 12 weeks, that's a window period. You know, a person can start getting any type of symptoms between headaches, nausea, diarrhea, and stuff like that. You know, like I emphasized in the book. And, you know, it's up to your body whether or not they can fight something off or it doesn't.
Right, right.
You know, and then once you get into going to the doctor and stuff like that, getting diagnosed, if you're not diagnosed, a doctor might be like, oh, okay, just continue to do what you're doing.
Right,
don't
right.
have any more risky behaviors, but come back in 6 months and let's see what's going on. You know what I'm saying? And see
they
if your body
the window period?
Yes, the window period. So what happens in that time is, you know, like even me, like sometimes I just go for rec because I don't like the way these people do these tests. When I first took my HIV test up north, I was scared to death because I was living high risk. Like, I didn't even know what a condom was.
Oh.
You know what I mean? So when the lady was sitting
there, a whole bunch of little tanks hanging around.
Nah, we don't do those. my pull-out game was second to none.
He ain't want no mini me, not at all.
Pull
out game strong.
Pull out with the gloves.
Pull out game. Pull out with the arms. Everybody wants to pull out strong.
Pretty much when I was sitting there and getting my result, you know, she was sitting there and she was like, yo, so you think you might be infected or anything like that? And I was like, hey, it can go either way. You understand what I'm saying? But the point that I'm trying to make is we had a conversation where she made me feel comfortable. You understand what I'm saying? Now it's like you go in there, they take your blood, yo, we'll call you back with your results. Like, they don't even try to give you any type of counseling or anything. You don't know what that person could be going through right now.
True.
Like, that person might be going through some shit in their head. Like,
true that.
Yo, I got this. I'm ready to kill myself. If this is, I'm going to kill this bitch because she gave me that.
Yeah.
Like, you don't know what's going on.
That's true.
And I'm not going to say that it's a bad policy because at the same time, you might have a high, what's the word I'm looking for? Like, you might have mad people that's coming in and out. But every time I go, I don't see that type of action happening. So when I go, it'd probably be like four people. So you telling me you can't spend 5 minutes with this person, try to gouge why they come to get a test.
Right, right.
And all that stuff, you know what I'm saying? Because if it's me, I'm certified to take the test. I just don't do it because I'm in a different field. I'm not in that field.
Oh, okay.
I didn't choose to be in the field, you know what I'm saying? But
gotcha.
If it's me, I'm going to sit and I'm going to be like, yo, Ned, what's happening? So what brings you in to take this test? You know what I'm saying? Like, you've been having risky behavior sex. Like, what's going on with your person? Like, what you doing?
Right,
you know what I'm saying? Are you in a heterosexual sex or are you the other type of sex? Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to try to get something out of him so I can know where his head is at. Because at the end of the day, once you give a person that result, you don't know what's going to happen.
That's true. You're right about that.
You understand what I'm saying?
That's very true.
And that is something that I even put in the book.
Yeah.
I had a situation where you told the wrong person that they got AIDS and he ready to shoot you now.
Yeah. Wow. So, you know what? As a matter of fact, let's get into that. Let's get into the book right now. So, the fact... So, you know, you had...
Well, let's not give too much of it.
Yeah, but saying that, you know, you had that dynamic of telling the wrong person that and then it ended up going into a lot of people. But the risky behavior... And the fact that the decisions that you make come back centerfold.
Yes.
And it affects not only you, but the people around you.
That's something
you know, you definitely should, you know, have the book. And you should read because it's such a dynamic of so many different turns.
Pretty much, you know, it's not, he really ain't give anything up like that. But what people really need to realize is... Like, I made a comment to y'all off camera, like, there's 6 degrees of separation.
There is.
You know, for a lot of people that don't know, you know, the people that are in the nightlife, they're pretty much, it's everybody knows everybody.
Yeah, everybody knows
everybody. I remember one time in, like, 2001, me and my partner used to party heavy every weekend.
Mm.
And it was a party. And then one time we went to Memorial Day weekend and the same promoters that we normally supported in New York, we went to Miami and supported.
Oh.
And when I tell you the same people that we partied with in New York were in Miami,
wow,
was outstanding. And that's when I realized, like, yo, listen, like, we're our own society, really.
Right.
Like,
yeah,
the people that go out in the clubs now, like, go to after hours and stuff like that.
Yeah, we used to go out heavy.
You fuck her tonight, I'm gonna fuck her 2 weeks from now.
Word.
How many times, Jay?
That's how it is, though.
Yeah, yeah.
Because at the end of the day, we're all just passing lovers around. Mm-hmm. It's just like Hollywood. You see people
one day, big time.
They with this person.
Oh, yeah.
In
big time.
5 months or a year, they with the next person.
I got next.
You understand what I'm saying? And that's pretty much what it is.
It's the culture, the Hollywood culture. You got the nightlife culture in New York City.
That's true, though.
Everybody knows each other.
That's all it is. It's a society where everything gets regurgitated.
Right.
And women are one of the people that get swapped around. You know what I'm saying? Just like the men. I'm not just going to say women.
I've been swapped around many times, too.
That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Well, the headline, you know, it makes you very appealing.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, listen, man. You know, he's very known in the Heights in the Bronx. So when he walk in the door, they got a beeline for Nelly Nell's hairline. Like, yo, you're the big homies in here. But don't give him. But Tank, you always gotta know. Don't give him no Cavassier because he don't know how to act.
Nah. We've been in.
No Cavassier for this guy.
Trust me, we've been in a party before. He was all right.
He was. He
behaved himself.
He ain't had no Cavassier. That's why he ain't have no Cavassier.
They tricked
at all.
Me. I thought it was Henny. It was Cavassier. What the fuck?
No Cavassier. Hennessy maybe.
Marcelo Chris.
You know. Marcelo is a little bit different.
Yeah,
you know,
Mr. Dark Liquor here.
Yeah, I like Dark Liquor, man.
Yeah, man. But listen, in the book, you know, you got a couple of characters, and one of the characters that stood out to me was Sucio. He was one of the ones that didn't know how to take the information he was given into a positive situation because he had turmoils from his childhood, and he ended up doing something real crazy in the whole story of the book. He ended up, you know... taking away somebody's life, you know what I mean? So not to get too much into a spoiler.
A couple people's life.
Yeah, a couple people's life. So That's back to what you were saying, like, you know, that sometimes, you know, they don't take out that time to really assess the situation when they're telling somebody that they're infected. And he's like, hey, you know what, buddy?
At the end of the day, man, these people don't care, man.
They don't care.
They don't care because, you know, it's something like I told y'all before. You can read somebody's energy. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? When somebody is you can tell when a person doesn't like their job. You can tell when a person likes their job.
100%.
You know? So you got people that's taking these tests and they're like, I'm just taking a test, man. I could care less if you positive or negative. But at the end of the day, it's like I said before, you don't know what that person is going through at that moment that they need that check. So one thing that I made sure in this book was that it's identifiable to everybody. It doesn't matter whether you're a person that's infected, not infected, nor a person that's infected. Once you read the book, you're going to be like, oh, shit. Like, this is some shit that I see daily, or I seen somebody with this situation, like it's identifiable. You feel me? Because at the end of the day, like I said, instead of me coming out here and being preachy about, yo, the virus is this, like I sit here all day on the show right now and just do a whole hour spiel on HIV and AIDS from a doctor's perspective. And people gonna, they're gonna tune out in about, before I even get to AIDS.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? HIV stands for human immunodeficiency virus. A stands for human, meaning that it can only be passed by one human to the next human. Immunodeficiency stands for,
that's all they're gonna hear, is wah,
you know what I'm saying?
Wah, wah,
exactly
wah,
my point. So what I did was I put a little sizzle on it.
Yeah.
You know, I put a story around it, so that way you're learning something, whether or not you think
So speaking on that, from
a story that I'm giving you.
So speaking on that, what was the thought process behind the characters?
Yeah.
The thought process,
especially the main three though.
Honestly, man, it might sound cocky and arrogant, but some people, well, I know people that write. So they'll do a whole outline of, all right, these are the characters. They're going to do character assessments. They're going to do chapter assessments and things like that. Me, I honestly went to sleep, had a dream, woke up, had a book. Only thing I had to do was get a typewriter and write it down. Shout out to my boy Mayhem.
Were any of these characters
based
on actual people you knew, or just like loosely based on it? Because sometimes, like, when you write,
nigga, was a dream, nigga.
I know why.
All right, because shout out to Mayhem. Mayhem was actually he was in the book, right?
Yeah,
Mayhem.
He was in the book. Yeah,
yeah.
But just to piggyback what you saying is, 75% of it has to do with my life experiences. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So as far as the characters was concerned, I know what I needed to catch people's attention. You feel me? So I already know, all right, this person is going to be this person. This person is going to be that person. Everybody's going to think this is the actual bad person in this book, when in all actuality, it's the virus. So let them keep thinking it's this, but you have no choice but to second and question about the virus.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because that's what drove the decision.
Then I give you the statistics at the end of the book, and it's like, holy shit.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's just like, it's pretty much, you know, started off like this and then just came together.
Yeah.
Because that's definitely how it was.
You know, for a person, when they read the book, they realize, like, holy shit, all these people are intertwined and 6 degrees of separation.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Because that's definitely like,
and once again, like I said, the nightlife is the same way. It's a society. You might not know this person knows that person until whenever.
Right.
Then
next
thing you know, holy shit, like,
wow.
You know?
That's crazy, man.
Yeah, and
just to give you another thing, like I was just saying before we started, there's a DJ down in South Carolina right now being brought on charges. He's talking about they saying he infected 600 women. I don't believe it's 600.
That's insane.
The point I'm trying to make is he knowingly doing was out here thing. Having sex with women unprotected.
Right, right.
Giving them the virus.
Right, that's crazy.
You know what
man.
I'm saying? So there's people out there, man, that that really on it like that. Not knowing that if they get caught, that's a class B felony and you will be going
to jail.
Wow. To jail for a long time.
A long time, wow. Yeah. And you know what? I'm going back to what you said, like, you know what I'm saying, like sometimes, you know, especially in modern day society, people have short attention spans. So you was able to create like a real nice storyline to actually give people information about the virus, but using society conflicts within our community to express it in your book, in a sense, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Through the nightlife, through somebody who's locked up, you know, in jail, the nightlife, somebody who's in the hood hustling, everything. Somebody who's big, you know what I mean?
A whole aspect,
because that gets people more in tune with, like, the actual storyline, and then all of a sudden they, oh shit, I just learned about HIV AIDS, you know what I mean?
Right.
It's like a way, like, to basically subliminally inform them of a real life threatening disease, you know what I mean? So that was great how you did that, and I really appreciate you for that, man. That's some Shakespeare type shit, you heard?
Yeah,
modern
man,
Shakespeare.
Like, honestly, man, that's why the book is short.
Yeah.
Because that's about the span that people got nowadays.
Yeah.
You know, even though, like I told y'all before, it was meant to be a movie, so I didn't know how to write a movie at the time.
Yeah.
And I read so many books, so I wrote a book, but I consciously made it short because, you know, I asked somebody the other day, I said, yo, do you read? She looked at me, she was like, ugh.
Really?
I was like, yo, do y'all understand how dope reading is?
Oh,
how much knowledge is in
it?
A book? Like, yeah. It used to be a point that if a book didn't pass 500 pages, I wasn't reading it. Because I already knew I'm gonna devour this book. Put it to you like this: a 500 page book would take me probably a day and a half to finish reading.
Mm.
You understand what I'm saying? So people don't know, man. There's a lot of knowledge in these books.
Absolutely.
And there's a lot of things that people don't want you to learn, and that's why they put it in books.
They put it in books. They do it to subliminal messages. And
message!
This is a perfect yes, buddy. And this is definitely one of the great ways. And I'm glad that you was able to implement that into your book, Vengeful. Which is a great book by Taino Domingo, a.k.a. Tank, Sugar Hill Gang. You hear Brat, Mahezy, you already know. Your mans is a beast, yo. I love him. Yo, Pops, man, stop fronting with 1833, heard? Whatever that fuck that shit mean.
You know
that's some sugar,
you
that's know some Sugar Hill Gang call,
that's
right?
That's the building, baby.
That's the building. I answer Gramps that, right?
Them.
I answer
Gramps
them.
Grams to them.
Grams to them. I know the building.
Oh,
I was just trying to find out if you was going to give it up or not. I wasn't trying to give it up.
Listen, man, Brick City. Brick City, y'all know where we from.
Oh, man.
Ain't nothing to hide.
Yeah, man. I bet.
That's crazy.
You know I love that building. Cause
building that makes legends.
You go to that building, man, it's like, it's mad chill, but if you fuck around,
legendary,
chill happen
man.
To you. You know what I mean?
Legendary.
I just wanted to say something real quick about what you said about books and reading books.
Yeah.
And that's one of the best things that I always took from reading was the stories and the vividness.
Mm-hmm.
And being able to escape within, you know, the confines of what the story brings.
Yeah.
You know, because I used to get teased a lot about reading. Oh, why are you reading? That's not
crazy
good.
Though.
Why are you doing
mean,
that?
What's...
And I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, yo, this book is fire. It's about like,
just even, bro,
it's about you know going into different places of the human imagination.
At me because one of my biggest genres is westerns.
Oh, okay.
So I read mad westerns. And people looking at me like
John Wayne ass nigga.
Look at this motherfucker.
Fucking cowboy.
Motherfucker.
He
always
wanna be a
cowboy. Some motherfucker.
He wanna be a cowboy.
He wanna be always on some gun shit.
You wanna be a cowboy. You got a Colt 45 on you. You got a Remington.
But you can't read.
Get off my lamb.
Can't read the Cat in the Hat, you know, but you worry about what I'm reading.
So, like, you know, like, he likes westerns. I like a lot of sci-fi fantasy.
Yeah, man. But check this out. I mean, one of the biggest learning tools is reading.
It is reading.
So,
man.
If you can't read or you don't know how to read, I suggest you learn. You know, you get some type of
reading
tutoring.
Books
and shit, because reading books.
Imagine
right
information
now,
a book has. Like,
honestly, just, man, if anybody right now has an infant or even any child within the 3 to 5 year old range. Put a book in their hand.
Oh, yeah,
man.
I do that with my daughter all the time.
Cause you gonna have
Absolutely.
A monster.
Absolutely.
You're gonna cultivate a monster.
Yeah, man.
I'm telling you.
Yeah.
And I mean,
it's inevitable, man.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Anybody that searches for knowledge is an individual that's gonna be successful.
Right.
Bottom line.
Absolutely. And like you said, though, man, it has so much information. And this is why people that at the power at B, they know that. Like Hitler, like the first thing he did was burn all the books.
All that.
He burned
that was everything. Always that was always all the number that. One thing you when you conquered anything was burn the knowledge.
Going back to Hitler, he burned all the books and dropped his book, The Mein Kampf.
Exactly.
Because right. he wanted people to learn. Follow, you know,
his
agenda, right? Right. So, right. I mean, you read The Mein Kampf before? That shit is sick.
Nah, I ain't read it.
It's sick.
Yo, but you know what's crazy? Remember we were talking about that yesterday?
Yeah.
About, like, you know, the power of knowledge and losing all that. Was the first thing that the Europeans did when they invaded Africa. Because Africa, way back when, people don't know this, was a major power. Oh, they absolutely. Controlled the world. They who were the first to have the books.
Who don't know that?
A lot of people.
I don't know.
A lot of people don't know that.
A lot of people don't really know that. They think that Africa was a black hole.
There's history for that.
You know, there's a black... I mean, now the access to the... You know, the internet brings so much access to the information.
Who don't know about Hannibal?
Mm. I mean, there's a lot of ignorant people out there. Who don't know
about all these other dudes besides Hannibal that was conquering Spain and Italy and England and all that?
Yeah.
Staying in Spain for 500 years and stuff like that.
Yeah. And it was... Not 2 days...
Not a decade.
You know, wow.
About 500 years. You know what that means?
Yeah.
That means y'all, we colonized y'all whole joint.
Yep.
You know, blacks in Africa, you know, for a long time, the conception was that Africa was this big black hole of savagery.
Nah,
well, in reality,
that's how history's taught.
But in reality, blacks were the first ones who had the civilizations. They were clean. They had baths, while these Europeans were sitting in their own filth and in their own dirt.
Let's if we want to go there,
Malik Ambar.
Let's go there.
Perfect example, Malik Ambar.
Now we're going to talk about this guy that we was talking about last week that didn't do anything but stumble upon something. Christopher Columbus. Columbus wasn't the first one to go around the Atlantic.
No.
The Africans were.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Like, even when he went on his voyage that he stumbled on the Caribbean islands, who did he have as a navigator? An African. You understand what I'm saying? People don't even understand that.
Yeah.
Like, this dude, first of all, never stepped foot on American soil and has a statue on 59th Street. For what reason? I have no idea. Like, I don't know why somebody would want to be like, yo, Christopher Columbus. Like, if I was you, I would check my history and be like, yo, I'm not even claiming that fool.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Because that's exactly what he was, a fool.
Yeah.
They gave him a boat 7 times it took him before he got a right to even leave where he was at. He thought he was in China.
Right.
Yeah, he thought he was in India. That's why he named them the Indians, because he thought he was in India.
At the end of the day, he came through and people showed him love. My people showed him love. Look, you want to come through? Yeah, you can... Go over here
because they were hospitality. You know, they were hospitable.
You know what I'm saying? What
the name of the ship was in Navidad. It was breaking down, and the Indians took him in and they helped them rebuild it to go back.
Listen, bro,
that's crazy, man.
Listen, man.
But you know, there's a meme out there.
See, but it's all
there's a meme out there. Hold on, I just want to say this real quick, then you can go. There's a meme out there that says white people taught us that black people are the most violent, but history dictates otherwise.
All right, listen, before you say something, bro.
But go ahead. Let me just.
Let me just ask you this. When was America ever great?
Never.
Never.
Ancient Aaron just left the building already.
It's funny how that's the rhetoric that this guy is promoting out here.
Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm. And I seen one blogger one day go on the street and ask white people, yo, when the last time America was great? You know how many people answered him with an answer? None.
None. Wow, that's crazy.
Because you can't.
Right.
Everything that America stands for and was built on was something that they stole.
Stole
ideas.
They didn't earn anything. They didn't build anything.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Like everything that you see.
Like reggaeton and salsa, how that was stolen too. And then they made it.
Listen, bro, America steals everything.
Everything.
They still owe
everything.
They still owe the British for everything that they own now, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? That's what the Civil War was about, man. People don't even know. Like, people got to read the fine print. That's why I said what I said earlier. Mm-hmm. If people understood how much power they have without being violent, this whole world would be different.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a fact. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Right. While you sitting here wanting to rob me for my gold and all this other stuff or whatever material shit that I got, that if I die and you die,
we both ain't gonna have it. We just need to be like, yo, you know what, man? I love you, bro.
Yeah, you're right.
They don't love us, though.
They don't. Yeah, you're
right. Let's make them love us.
Right.
And we don't have to do that violently.
No, mm-hmm. definitely.
You understand what I'm saying? Yeah.
You know, they had a picture of skeletons. And the skeletons all looked the same. And on the top it said black, white, Asian,
oh yeah, yeah,
Spanish,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. blue, black, yellow, white.
Message! But it's the truth, though.
But it were all skeletons that looked exactly like.
Yeah. Right, right, right.
Because you wouldn't know.
Nah, you can.
Because...
Yeah, you can't through different like
if you want to be technical about it
with the structure of the bones.
Yeah, exactly, the structure of the bones will tell you. But pretty much the premise is, motherfucker, we all turn the bones.
We all the same. Yeah, we all turn the bones. We all bleed the same. We all
skeletons, nigga.
So
you shoot me, I shoot you. We all die the same.
It's just the fact of, man. You know, at the end of the day, I told my cousin the other day, man, I don't want to be taking space in this world. You know what I'm saying?
That's deep.
I came into this world. And I was meant to be doing something to make
Absolutely.
A difference.
And you are
not
doing
just
it.
To take space.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? So all these individuals that's just taking up space, you just need to remove yourself. You know what I'm saying?
Get out the way, man.
It's just move, bitch. It's sad, man.
You're right about that.
Sad.
It's like
you're taking up space,
life, man. Like,
yeah, man.
It's a waste of
sad,
life
man.
To see someone that just doesn't do nothing.
But also
if you're taking
also up, to give people the benefit of the doubt, like we said off air, some people don't know what they're putting this world.
They don't know,
You know what I'm saying? Everybody's epiphanies is going to be at a different point.
That's true.
It's not going to be whatever I gained 10 years ago. Yeah. You're not going to gain 10 years ago. It might be this year coming.
Right, right, right.
You understand what I'm saying? So everybody's different. But the fact of you just being out here just breathing is just beyond
crazy,
me, man.
If you're taking up space, better get out the way because Big Tank gonna roll over you.
That's right, man. That's right, man. So let's do a little.
I'm just about peace, man.
No, I hear that. Same here, man.
I just.
I know your shirt. Your sweatshirt says otherwise. It says Bone Roller.
Yeah, boom. You know.
That means you roll with people with a tank, or oh, you mean
shout out to my boy, man. You know what I'm saying? Cello, we repping.
Yeah, man.
But man, it's like I said, violence.
I really
there's
believe
nothing,
that
there's
humans.
Nothing, there's nothing coming out of violence.
Man. I really believe that humans rather live by each other's happiness rather than by each other's miseries. Like, I mean, I think all of us want to live in harmony.
I don't believe that.
You know what I'm saying? I think.
So many miserable people
in this
world.
I can't
say
nature, man, but I think us as human beings, we have that automatic. But it's just that it's a learned behavior where now you have. A certain ego in you now that you want to be, you know, have that power, have that advantage. But we're not born like that. It's something that, you know, happens throughout
society.
Life. Right, society. So
society raises us, man.
It's yeah.
Because, look, from the age of 0 to 7, children are what? Pretty much raised by their family.
Right, right.
After that, they're raised by society.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So whatever you instill in your child within that time range, you got to say to yourself, please, Lord, let whatever I instilled in this child be able to help them move forward in life.
Right, right.
Because
absolutely.
After that, they're influenced by their friends. They're influenced by TV.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying? And just to, I don't mean to disagree with what you say or anything like that, but bro, there's too many miserable people out here. Like, look, I'll give you, for instance, whenever you see somebody doing good, me and you will be like, well, applaud it.
Mm-hmm.
But somebody in their inner circle be like,
fuck that nigga.
I could do the same shit though.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But that comes from somewhere, you know, though. Like, why is that person doing that? Because of what they've been through.
But you know, the majority is that.
Mm.
Instead of the majority applauding and saluting.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's just like, you know, bringing back the Nipsey. Like, yo, how can somebody allow somebody to take him out? I can't even. That shit, I still can't sit with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
you understand crazy. What I'm saying? Like, I don't give a fuck what you had in your brain, bro. Mm-hmm. Like, if I was standing there with Nip, there's no way. I don't give a fuck how many shots you taking, bro. You gonna have to hit me because you gonna take him out. Mm-hmm. Somebody that's doing so much for the community,
right, right, right.
And that means so much globally, not only just
for
LA, man. Like, that was crazy, yeah, man. Right.
If you got somebody in your team like
this
that,
this is a prime example of hater shit.
Yeah.
Cause you couldn't handle whatever he told you and just ate it. Cause you a fuck nigga.
Yeah.
And you couldn't accept
You and being that fuck nigga.
Yeah, and the fuck the funny thing is that he was being told the truth.
That's what I'm trying to tell you, though.
So when you got somebody in your team who has that ability, who's doing positive things and progressive things in society, you got to protect that person 100%. Like I said, like Tank said, had I been there, bro, I would have been in four eyes, nigga. Nobody's getting close to my dude, bro. Nobody's getting close.
Ain't no way in the world. I can't.
I'm not Superman, but I'm not. Yeah, ain't nobody getting close to my dude.
I'm not. I want to be clear. I'm not trying to talk down to anybody that was there when the situation went down. I'm not trying to belittle you in any situation. I'm just saying, me personally, I can't see me being there and allowing somebody like Nip just to be taken out this world. By a bitch ass nigga in a bitch ass way. Yeah. That shit just doesn't sit well with me.
I hear you.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And it comes back to what I was saying. Motherfuckers like that don't need to be breathing.
Yeah, absolutely.
You see what I'm saying?
And it's perfect example.
That's one person of many that's taking up space in this world.
Yep.
Because only thing you bring in now is misery in this world. Mm. You understand what I'm saying? Instead of this man that's bringing a change into the world. You want to extinguish that.
And that change is ultimately going to help that same nigga who's being a bitch ass nigga.
Come on, man.
Right.
And the whole thing is,
I think Tank deserves a clap for that. Give him a clap for that.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
that was he needed a clap for that.
Nah, that's all right, man, cuz this is just, you know what I'm saying, what it is, man. Only real people can understand that. And I'm not even going to say real, cuz that shit is like, you know, real is a perspective. What's real to you is not going to be real to me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, for me, I say authentic. You know what I'm saying?
And humble.
You can't dispute that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Authenticity is what it is, man. And there's too many people running around here
just
lying, man.
Yeah, man. I'm telling you. And that's why when I be out and about, like with my, you know, with my crew or my homies, they always be like, yo, now why you be bugging out? Why you be taking shit too serious? Why you always on point? Why you always looking around and surround us, making sure that we all good? I'm like, dude, what do you mean? Like, I'm not gonna let a miserable dude just come and fuck up our vibes or end up hurting you or me. And we're trying to have fun tonight, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, bro, listen, every
You gotta be diligent, man. You have to be on point 100%. You can't think that everybody's good out there, you know what I'm saying?
Just to piggyback on what you said, every weekend there's somebody going to a club. And they shining, and by the end of the night, somebody's holding a gun to them, taking their shit.
Word.
That is mad corny, but that goes back to what I'm saying. Like, you got people, like, look, there was just something on the gram last week. Dudes robbed this dude.
And the 12, and the next 211, thing you know, 211 BP gas station.
Nah, and made in Mexico. Then
the gas station where he was getting robbed, he was under the truck.
Yeah.
Then the three guys pulled up on him. He was in the gas station there.
Now the next day, these dudes is on Instagram
posting it up like
come on,
oh, flossing the thing they stole from him.
Yeah, like,
that's stupid.
First of all, you want to jail. Second of all, like, how much money you really getting off of that, bro?
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Like, the mindset is just
you're
retarded,
right about that,
bro.
It is.
Instead of somebody being like, yo, let me watch this dude and see how I can come up.
Right.
People just automatically be on some old, man, fuck that,
motherfucker. It's that jealousy,
I'm gonna
though,
take
man,
this shit.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so
it's insecurity, too.
Yeah.
It's that miserable shit.
Yeah.
Because instead of you going out there and working to get you some shines, if that's what you want.
Right.
Regardless, and I'm not even going to sit here and be like, yo, working 9 to 5, if you want to be illegal. Fam, work for your shit. What you got to take some shit for?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because you lazy and you think this is the fastest way, because everybody not going to be down with getting robbed now. You got some people that's going to buck.
Oh, yeah. They're going to definitely.
You know what I'm saying? So what you going to do once that person buck?
Right.
You feel me?
Right.
So it's like, yo.
You lost your life over a chain, bro.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but he was in Made in Mexico, which is a real popular lounge / restaurant in Uptown 212th Street, 10th Avenue, Manhattan. And most people that go there who have nice cars, whatever, they park in the parking lots. There's a parking lot in the BP gas station across the street from Made in Mexico. The guy was making himself, you know, he was making his way out towards his car. And right before he got to his car, the three guys approached him, guns pointed, threw him on the floor. And the guy, you know, he was smart enough to give up his jewelry and not really, you know, get into a fight with them. He crawled under a Jeep. The guys dipped in a white Jeep, and that was all. That was all. Was
they
it?
They posted it.
And then it was the next day. They was posting it in the pawn shop, getting the money for it. Corny. Posting the ones that they stayed with. Posting the money that they got off of it. Like, two dumbasses.
Corny.
That's crazy.
They just incriminate themselves.
That's
what
I'm saying. It's exactly.
That's stupid, exactly, bro. That, and, you know, and that's crazy how, like, that's how a lot of niggas get caught, is because they be on Instagram. Oh, and there's actual society, cops, bro. Got society. Special fucking, like,
of course, they're on top of
people that are, like, there just to hit their social media, just to see stupid motherfuckers like that.
It's crazy, man. Type of world we live in, man. But let's wrap this up, though, man.
Let's wrap it up real quick with the HIV. The first clinically observed case was in 1981, since we were talking about it. That's when they really started actively, like, CDC, clinically, like, diagnosing
CDC
it, you know what I mean?
Got on top of it and started monitoring it from then on.
Yeah, and they said that it stems from something called zoonosis, which is a parasite that comes from animals and it originated in Africa from a monkey. So,
that's what I'm about to say,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, also,
that's speculation.
Speculations, yeah. And also bestiality. Which is when humans interact with animals sexually.
Once again, speculation.
Kind of like what Tony Tampa said about cow fucking and all that.
Yeah,
that.
So zoonosis is one of those. It kind of falls in the same a predicament of bestiality. You know, so people exchanging sexual behavior with animals and then you going back and having sex with their spouses or whoever it is and contracting gonorrhea.
Yeah, let's be real, not like to cut you off. Like, you really believe that?
I mean, I don't believe 100%.
You got a sheep herder out there having sex with his sheep and then going.
You don't know my uncle in DR, huh?
Well, gonorrhea is one of those things that came from that too. So I mean, you gotta think about it. I mean, you know, but I will say this,
bro. The only thing that I could really say, man, that I out there that know that was prevalent before all this shit is tuberculosis, man.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Back in the days, that's all anybody had to worry about. Yeah. Nobody had to worry about syphilis, gonorrhea, or any other STD. The major thing, matter of fact, let me reiterate that. The two major things that was diabetes and TB, bro.
Yeah.
Mm. And you take from that statement what you want to.
And there was I forgot the name of the movie, but you should look it up online. It's a movie based on the syphilis thing. It was actually it was a man-made thing that was injected into particularly the black community from a black doctor who was, like, privileged, who was getting paid a lot of money to do research on it. Look it up. It was, like, in the mid, like, early 30s or late 20s. Yeah, it's a movie.
I'm going to look it up then.
I'm going to look it up and I'm going to send it to you guys.
That's
but, yeah.
That's okay. What Tom Capone got killed by.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Al Capone. Yep. Out of syphilis.
Wow. So let's do our final thought, man. I mean, HIV again. I mean, this topic is very, you know, I mean, you know, Taino Domingo definitely went more in depth because he has a lot of background knowledge of it. And especially the book definitely talks about it. And definitely your approach of just trying to get readers to basically understand the main idea without, you know, giving the whole lecture about HIV. But you put it into a story format, which is a dope idea, man. I definitely got to finish up reading the book, though, man, because I know we spoke about it, but I definitely want to read the book from beginning to end, man.
Yeah, being that you a teacher, man, I really want your feedback on that.
Oh, yeah, no, most definitely, man. Most definitely, man. So who wants to start off the final thought right now, man, HIV?
As we always do, we go around. And they'll start.
Go around the round table there, little buddy.
Let's go, man.
Yo. Even though his hairline is pristine, you know, I got the, you know, I got the privilege.
Shots fired.
I got the privilege and honor to see the process, you know, being done while I dropped the book off to him because he definitely wanted to do it.
When he came to drop off the book, Vengeful. I tell you, I'm on the shop, man. Come see me.
I got to see the process and the
you seen the magic happen.
The technicality and the sophistication.
He was watching the magic happen run in front of his eyes, man. He couldn't hold himself, so he had to leave.
Master at work. There was a master at work, you know.
Oh my God.
But yeah, man. Basically, you know, just be very careful how you conduct yourself, and risky behavior can really determine the rest of your life. Definitely. Be more knowledgeable and try to do more research on what can lead up you to having a disease that can ultimately cause your life to end and terminate yourself. Also, be mindful that, you know, there is people who live with these with certain diseases, and you know that you can contract them too if you don't behave properly, and you know, just try to be the best human being you can, man. Don't be taking up space. You heard? Nelly Nell from Dinner at the Roundtable Podcast.
Oh, man. So So, man, Taino, man, what's your final thought, man, just overall?
Pretty much, man, just check your status, man. Regardless to whatever, you know, it's good to know your status. You never know. Like I said earlier, you don't know who out here just by looking at them, whether or not they are infected. And you don't even know if you're infected because, like I said, there's window periods. There's a time in the body where it takes for the antibodies to come out and then a person finds out their status. You know, so just do yourself a favor, man. Even if you meet somebody and y'all feel like y'all ready to take it to the next level, just go over there and just, you know what I'm saying, tell them straight up, like, listen, boo, you know what I mean? I'm feeling you, and I think we finna take it to the next level. And why don't we go get tested and find out we all good, you know what I'm saying? Before we make this next step. And simple as that, man. Your boy, Taino Domingo in the building. You already know Sugar Hill.
Yes, sir, man.
So I'm going to keep this short and sweet. I definitely respect my dude over here for, you know, having the, you know, the fortitude to create a book and do it in a way that's both informative, educational, but also entertaining. Right. And that's the best form of education, is to have that entertaining factor to it. And I definitely respect anybody who, you know, has, you know, the mindset to do something such big, because this is a really big thing to have a book out there and to say I wrote something that, you know, will last forever, because you never know, 100 years from now somebody could walk into, you know, a library, or they can go into the audiobook and they can swipe through and see this book Vengeful, and it offers them a story about the HIV, and that's something that'll resonate forever. You know, and I think about how our podcast, it's the same thing, where our audio will resonate, you know, and it'll reach, you know, a broader audience. And I definitely respect you, my brother, for creating such a great book. It's definitely something that I recommend anybody to read. It's amazing. It's definitely entertaining. It's a really, really good book, and I definitely, you know, want people to read it. Yeah, and like I said, man, I respect my brother here for, you know, having the fortitude to create something so great. And, you know, still at the Roundtable Podcast, we definitely stand by independency. And this is definitely and the first author on the book, on the podcast, my brother. And we respect the hell out of you for that, man.
One more thing. I want to appreciate y'all for allowing me to be up in this platform with y'all, man. And, supporting my book and things of that, man. All the words are greatly appreciated, y'all.
Of course, man. We gotta be definitely, and that's what we do, man. That's what we do here, man. We support everybody, including both Bodega and DJ that's been silent the whole podcast, bro.
Yo, author of Vengeful, man. You already know, man. Books and Nobles. What is it? Barnes and Noble.
Shout out
to you, man. Sugar Hill, y'all.
And
that's it for me, baby.
So let me just end it off real quick, though, man. Again, man, Taino Domingo, man. Thanks for coming through, man. A lot of information was shared, man. I mean, you definitely provided a lot that, you know, things that I really didn't know too much about. And I'm pretty sure the listeners, viewers right now didn't know too much about, man. So I definitely appreciate the knowledge that you definitely dropped, man, because that's something that should be spoken about more often. And yes, and more people are not really informed about, you know, something about the HIV. It's a serious disease. But thankfully, I do notice that they are trying to make prevention drugs now for it. So that's a good start. And hopefully this could be a cure, man, because it's a very deadly disease, and we got to be more informed about this, man. So, again, I appreciate you for coming over here, man, to the Roundtable Podcast, and just dropping those jewels, bro. You know what I'm saying? Definitely, man. So we're going to end it off. You know what I'm saying? Then at the Roundtable Podcast, make sure you tune in. We on all digital platforms each and every Sunday, 7 p.m. Peace out.
Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Let's talk credit card debt for a minute. If you feel you're carrying too much of it, you're not alone. The average household in the U.S. carries over $8,000 in credit card debt. Ready for some good news? With a cash out refinance from Quicken Loans, you can quickly and easily put some of the equity in your home to good use by paying off a lot of that high interest credit card debt. A great way to take cash out is with our 30-year fixed rate mortgage. The rate today on our 30-year fixed rate mortgage is 3.99%, APR 4.08%. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN to learn how taking cash out with a 30-year fixed mortgage might be the right solution for you. And for a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rates subject to change. Pay 1.25% fee to receive this discounted rate. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Let's talk credit card debt for a minute. If you feel you're carrying too much of it, you're not alone. The average household in the U.S. carries over $8,000 in credit card debt. Ready for some good news? With a cash out refinance from Quicken Loans, you can quickly and easily put some of the equity in your home to good use by paying off a lot of that high interest credit card debt. A great way to take cash out is with our 30-year fixed rate mortgage. The rate today on our 30-year fixed rate mortgage is 3.99%, APR 4.08%. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN to learn how taking cash out with a 30-year fixed mortgage might be the right solution for you. And for a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rates subject to change. Pay 1.25% fee to receive this discounted rate. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.